from West Texas.
Thanks, Bill. And you're listening to the Bill Hallwig Memorial Summer Season every Thursday on the Sonic Society feed. Brought to you by Broken Sea Audio at BrokenSea.com and everyone who loved and knew Bill Hallwig. The theme music for this special series, Mr. Buccaneer, comes to us courtesy of Howl O at howlo@wordpress.com. I'm Jack Ward. And tonight's show is from another grand fan fiction piece from the 1970s cult classic show, Kolchak, The Night Stalker. A little later, we'll speak with Jeffrey Adams from Radio Icebox about his role as Kolchak and his memories about Bill. But first, let's link up with our amigos. Jeff Billard, hello.
Hi, Jack.
And Lothar Tuppen, how are you tonight?
I'm doing great. Hi, Jack. Hi, Jeff.
Hi, Jeff. Hi, Lothar.
Now, Kolchak is a show I didn't hear about until I was an adult. I don't know if it ever played in Canada. Did you guys know about this show?
Oh yeah. Oh, it, I mean, the movie was on, major network, and then the TV series that followed it after, was it their Night Strangler was the second movie? There might have been a third movie that I'm blanking on, and then there was the series. And, yeah, Darren McGavin and
Darren McGavin.
Dan Curtis was a big deal in United States TV at that time period, whether it be Dark Shadows or a number of other made-for-TV movies that were all really pretty cool. Jeff, what are your memories of, like, not only Night Stalker, but Dan Curtis shows in general?
You know, the funny thing is, Night Stalker, you know, I remember Darren McGavin because, you know, he was such a great actor in that part and other movies, too. And we used to watch it all the time. It was just a fun show. He was a great character. I liked the characters there. You know, he was just, I don't know, he just had this something great to him. And, of course, he had, you know, that signature hat, and I saw it in the logo that Bill probably designed, you know, with the hat in there and everything. And Dark Shadows was incredibly popular. We used to come home from school. It was on at like 3 o'clock in the afternoon or 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yep.
You know, we'd come home from school and we'd always watch it. I just remember I used to talk with Bill about Dark Shadows because he always wanted to do it. Dark Shadows.
Oh, he was such a huge Dark Shadows fan.
Yeah.
This is another I never saw Dark Shadows either. I never heard of it until Bill mentioned it to me.
Really? Because it used to be on, like I said, in the afternoon here in the United States. And we talked about it so many times. And I remember telling him how much, I think it was Quentin, the guy in the attic there, the ghost in the attic. That guy used to freak me out. You know what I mean? And it was great. So it's just great stuff. And it was just right in that zone for Bill.
So what got Bill all excited about doing Kolchak in the first place? I remember him telling me about it, and he was really psyched.
Oh. Well, it's a zeitgeist of Americana in the 70s, which is, you know, that same time period for all the Broken Sea guys and me as well. Jeff, you're just a little bit older, but I think you're probably, yep, you know, still riding that wave, which is
right.
There were all these weird TV movies that were coming out in the 70s that were actually pretty good horror and weird occult things that you could just watch on TV, but they were almost as hard hitting as like a PG horror movie, especially when you're 8 or 10 or even probably 16 or, you know, 17.
Right.
And there's a number of those that just tweaked your brain. You watch them and they stuck with you for years. And then you're an adult and you're like, yeah, this is still there. And Bill was definitely a part of that. And Dan Curtis did, you know, not only Dark Shadows and Night Stalker were probably like his two biggest ones. But then there was a bunch of these other weird pilots that never went anywhere. One that I recommend everybody to go see because I think it's actually available on DVD still from Netflix is the Norlis tapes. That was a pilot similar to Night Stalker in that it was a journalist experiencing all this stuff. But the concept for the Norlis tapes to sort of show the weirdness that was around Dan Curtis is the publisher of this journalist gets a note that basically this guy's been missing for a long time, but they found a bunch of tapes from him. So he finds these tapes, and this journalist has been missing for X amount of time, maybe a year, maybe more, I can't remember. And so he plays the first tape, and he realizes that this guy's gotten involved with some sort of like weird occult satanic thing, and he basically did a Night Stalker sort of like, you know, save the people from the day. But we still don't know what happened to him, so the guy's going to listen to the next. And the pilot never went anywhere, but that would have been the concept for the show, is this publisher trying to figure out what happened to my journalist by listening to all these tapes that are slowly piecing the whole thing together.
Cool.
I've never even heard of that. That sounds amazing.
Yeah, for some reason it didn't get picked up. Maybe it was too derivative of the Night Stalker. Yeah, so for those of us growing up at that time, you just turn on you know, ABC, NBC, CBS at the right time, and you're going to get some weird show, you know, probably fit in between two episodes of, you know, Streets of San Francisco and Cannon.
Quinn Martin production. Yeah.
Quinn Martin production. And, yeah. And
I remember those.
I always thought that if I was going to have all the money in the world to do like my own network, my network would be all about failed pilots. We just show all the time, all these pilots that never went anywhere. And then, you know, if you have enough people subscribing, we would like relaunch your favorite pilot and as a series kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I thought that would have been kind of cool.
That would be cool.
But I think one thing about to get back to Dark Shadows and how much Bill liked it is Dark Shadows found this kind of niche at, you know, right in the afternoon that people at my age, you know, and I don't forget what years it was on, but I was in high school in the early 70s. You know, we'd come home and like I said, we'd watch it and then you'd go out and do something afterwards. It was like appointment television for a lot of young people. And Bill was right in on that. And he loved that whole thing because it had such a breath to it with all those characters. Barnabas Collins and, you know, great names like Kolchak and Night Stalker and Barnabas Collins. And you know what I mean? Quentin Collins. It's like a thing. One of the things I always love about Dickens, not to equate this with Dickens, except that I always felt like Dickens always came up with these incredible names for his characters, you know,
names that sounded like who they were.
Exactly. Didn't he? I mean, he was just amazing at that. And Bill just loved it. I can hear his voice right now. Kolchak, and that's so cool. You know, and the conversations that we'd have, he'd get so excited. And he was so excited about, he loved, this is early again,
yep.
Kolchak. This is like, what, 07, 09, somewhere in there. I looked it up today, but when I was...
I think it was 06, but maybe 07. Maybe I'm getting mixed up with one of the other ones I was listening to today.
Yeah, so it's early stuff, the Kolchak stuff. You know, and Bill wrote, when you listen to it, when I listen to it today, and it just has that humor that Bill had, you know, that with the, and I forgot what's the stuff that gets all over his suit?
The yak poop.
Yak poop, right. That gets all over yak poop doesn't come out of white suits. You know,
it's white seersucker. It doesn't come out
of white seersucker. Yes, exactly. You know, and that was just so Bill.
He had so many great lines. I think the three things I really come away from Bill's adaptation of The Night Stalker with is one, how much he brought that 70s mythology to life to where you feel like you're in that mythic decade. And he makes that so powerful. And part of the way he does that is through his use of diegetic sound, which, you know, he blurred it from like, okay, so they're listening in the car and then it gets really loud as something goes and then you pan back and then it's back in the car again. You know, he just did that so stylistically that was perfect for that style, whether it would be Iron Butterfly or Ethel Merman or the Rolling Stones.
Rolling Stones is what I was just going to mention. Yeah.
You know, and then the third thing is, of course, the humor where you've got Yak Poop, which is just hilarious, and the whole Salami family, which for all of you who have not listened to it yet, who are going to listen to it now, the Salami family is hilarious, and they deserve a whole show in and of themselves. And the line, which I'm probably paraphrasing a little bit, but it stuck in my head, was where his publisher, Tony, says, you know, in regards to stop talking about vampires, and he's like, don't say it, don't think it, don't eat garlic bread. And I'm like, perfect Bill humor. I love that line.
Speaking of Bill's humor and his lines, did he have a process of editing or did he do all his own editing? He never really sent me as many of his scripts as I would get more of his, you know, final cuts of stuff or his continuing cuts of stuff.
It was Paul's wife, Damaris Mannering, who was the main editor early on in the days. I don't know more than that, except for Bill would talk about times where she would come back and say, I'm going to take your exclamation key away from your keyboard if you keep doing this. You don't need more than one. And he's like, yes, I do. I do need more than one exclamation point.
Oh, he did.
His point, which I think that a lot of people don't get, is that you need to give so much strong stage direction to the actors that it is not a grammatical imperfection to have something fully bolded or five exclamation points after something or whatever. Anything that gets across into their head is what's necessary.
Yeah, I had this problem with David all the times when we were doing our like little pastiches of audio drama stuff, right? Saying, okay, I'm having you yell again. Make sure you're yelling because you're trying to yell over like wind or something like that, and he rarely did that, and I think he was too afraid to wake up people in the house.
Well, Bill, when you read his scripts, to answer your question, Jack, he he sent me a lot of scripts, but he wasn't asking me for a lot of feedback. He would just send them. He was never bashful about, like you said, Lothar, exclamation points or capital letters or using color,
yep.
You know, in it
to
get his point across. And he wasn't bashful about any of that. And when you read a Bill's script, it was kind of compact, wasn't it? I mean, do you know what I mean? It wasn't... It was like jammed up. It just came through his fingers onto the keyboard, man. I can just see it just whipping right out of him.
Yes.
You know, but they were amazing. But they just looked, they had this look of kind of not chaos, but energy to them.
It's almost like if it wasn't typed, it felt like it was handwritten.
That's a good way to put it. There was an energy to those scripts. And I always loved it when he sent them, you know, because they were just so him.
Yeah.
You know,
everything about Bill, from his acting to his mixing to his writing to his, you know, visual artwork, everything about him is dynamic. So, you know, that would probably be like the one word I would put around is dynamism is Bill Holweg when it comes to, you know, the way he approaches art.
Do you think that's what slowed down his production later on? It's just he just lost so much energy.
It might be. It was a lot of also just, you know, running out of time and having to do too much. And, yeah, we're unfortunately mortal and... you know, it's hard to keep that energy up when you're, you know, spending it in every single direction you've got in your life.
And I think that's it. You know, I just remember lots and lots of emails about, you know, life getting in the way and having to work and doing side jobs. And
you know, it was up until about, 2012, 2013, that he had that really steady job with that one graphic design company. When you know that you've got a steady job that you can just show up, you do your work, you go home.
Yeah.
That allows you to have all that energy to go anywhere else. And after that point is when he had to continually hustle for new gigs, keep moving from place to place because the market was starting to dry up. And I think that was a big shift for him.
That's when I noticed that it was a big shift in his production, a big shift in his attitude, a big shift in so much of those things. Yeah,
it was. And I think he got very tired, and because he would mix at 4 o'clock in the morning, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, he would get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and for whatever, an hour and a half, he would mix a lot in the morning. And then I think life just got more and more hectic for him, or more and more daunting, or whatever the word you want to use. And I think what he really wanted to do was he really wanted to do his Planet of the Apes, and he really wanted to do Amity. And he would say in 2109, he would send me emails and go, "I'm just dying to do 2109. I haven't touched it in 3 or 4 months."
Yeah,
you know. And I think he had all this stuff he was dying to get back to, but it was just hard for him to make the time, or because he had so much he was working on too.
Yeah.
I mean, he had so much going on at the same time, and then he was doing, and I think that's why when, you know, he had you do the Planet of the Apes UK stage show, Othar, you know what I mean? I just think it was him realizing that you know what, I just can't do all this, and I want it done, and I know Lothar is going to do an amazing job in realizing that he just couldn't do it all.
Yeah, and that's, you know, I think everybody out in the world has heard people say, "Oh, I just don't have enough time," and it's like, you know, we all have the same amount of hours in the day. More often than not, it comes to prioritization.
Right.
And the frustrating thing, and I think what was really getting Bill down, was that daily survival to support for him and his family and all of that was starting to just look like a never-ending battle.
I agree.
Just want to sort of wrap this up because we're moving on time to 15 minutes and we still have a little interview with Jeff Adams before we get to listen to this week's show.
Jeffrey Adams rocked it so much as Kolchak.
Oh, he was great. God,
I mean, he's so great in so many ways. And this is just listening to it again recently for the show. He's just so incredible.
Yep, I agree.
We're down to the last 4 episodes of our special this summer. And Kolchak, the order, people ask, well, why are they ordered this way? The order came from the Facebook group, Audio Drama Radio Drama Lovers. I put it up as a poll as to what was people's most favorite, what they wanted to hear. And so I've done this in reverse order. So it says a lot about these 4 episodes of Kolchak that it hit the top 4.
Awesome. I didn't realize that. Wow. Bill would be very, very happy about that, I can tell you. I can assure you.
Yeah, and I think some of his other shows, they didn't reach the highest one because people felt they weren't as complete, you know, in that respect.
Yeah.
So without any more further ado, let's go to Jeffrey Adams and the little interview I had with him, and then onwards to the Night Stalker. Thanks so much, guys. We'll see you at the other end.
Okay.
And I'm here with Jeff Adams, the grand patron of modern audio drama. That sounds a whole lot better and more impressive than grandfather. Jeff's the writer, director, producer, host, and creator of Radio Icebox, Icebox Radio. Dozens, maybe hundreds of audio drama scripts right now. And how are you, sir?
I am just well, Jack. It's so good to hear from you again. And thank you. And I will totally take the grandfather label. I do have grown children. No grandkids yet, but it's not that far out of the realm of possibility.
Now I just imagine, because so much has changed in audio drama, I just imagine you wandering around in a great robe, you know, with a staff, ready to cast spells and pass on your wisdom, because you are one of the first. So we're doing a retrospective of Bill Hallwig this summer, as you know, and I just wanted to know what are some of your memories of Bill, because you knew Bill probably as long as all of us.
Well, probably on the in terms of time, yes, I would think that that would make sense. Bill was someone that I kind of got on my radar back when I was doing a podcast called Sound Stages, and this would have been 2005 or 6, and that was through his work with Broken Sea Audio. And it it always struck me that when I listened to something for Broken Sea, the quality was a little bit, you know, a notch above. There was a lot of new shows in those days. But not all of them were, you know, particularly great. And the quality, especially the sound design that Bill did, was really, really exceptional. And the other thing that struck me was just the variety, that he seemed to be so amazed and interested in so many different kinds of stories. And I know that in later years, he became sort of a confirmed fan fiction advocate and a big believer in kind of the amateur auteur ethic. And in that way, I think we were maybe a bit different, because I had young kids at home and was looking at ways that maybe audio could turn into a living for me. But you could never doubt the man's enthusiasm. In fact, I think that the thing that really impressed me about Bill, and the thing I'll always remember about him, was when the website Audio Drama Talk came online. And to me, this was a very, very important website, because this was the first place online where everybody seemed to be. You know, there was always there's always new websites and new directories going up, and back in the day, listservs and that kind of thing. But ADT was like the one place where it seemed, Greg Taylor was there, and you were there, and Fred Greenhouse from Final Rune was there, and it just seemed everybody in the scene was present. And I really feel like Bill kind of was the patron saint of that website. In fact, I went back and looked when he passed away, and he had over 10,000 posts on Audio Drama Talk.
Wow.
And that's the thing I really associate with him. You know, the truth be told, I don't believe I ever heard the man's voice. I think we wrote back and forth quite a bit, but I just remember his words and his enthusiasm, and how often, if I put up a post on Audio Drama Talk, the first person to comment on it was going to be Bill. And often the comment was just, wow, or cool, or something like that. But he always commented.
Speaking of the fan fiction side of things, he asked you to be involved in a project that was near and dear to both your hearts. So what was that like?
That was, of course, Kolchak the Night Stalker, a script penned by Bill himself called the All Saints Archive. And Kolchak the Night Stalker, for the uninitiated, was a television show from the 70s, very short-lived show starring Darren McGavin, who is that guy from that era. If you don't know the name, just Google image Darren McGavin, and you'll say, oh yeah, that guy. I've seen him in a bunch of movies. And it was Chris Carter of The X-Files actually listed Night Stalker as a very influential show for him when he was looking to develop a television series. It was the story of a reporter in Chicago who, we were to believe just by happenstance, every week came up against some kind of monster, some kind of ghost, some kind of paranormal goings-on. And you got the impression that Carl never actually got his story in the paper, because he had a bombastic editor by the name of Tony Vincenzo, and Tony never believed anything. He was the hardened cynic. And some of the best scenes in that show were the two of them arguing it out. And much in the tradition of Planet of the Apes and Logan's Run and James Bond and all the other fan fictions that Bill did, he was a big Night Stalker fan as well. And he wrote me, I forget how we made the initial connection, but I think I might have heard about it, written him and said I'd love to audition. And I came up with like the best Darren McGavin impression I hesitate to call it an impression because really all I other went really went with was like trying to get the rhythm of his voice. He had this very rapid way of speaking, and this was very reporterly, if that's not a word, but you know what I mean. At 4:15, Chicago, the vampires were out, but no one would believe me until I got absolute proof. And he seemed impressed with it, and we had a lot of fun. You know, it was actually my one and only foray into true remote acting, where I just recorded my lines and sent them along, and then later on, I got back an MP3 that was, oh, look, my line together with, well, there, you know, there was actually some pretty big names in this. Going down the credit list, I was trying to remember, Zombie Astronaut, Ralph Walters, he was Tony Vincenzo, and I was just looking, I just called this up, oh yeah, Gwendolyn Jensen Woodard was in this particular story, Taylor Kent, he was in there as well, and it was a whole lot of fun. I'm not a big fan of the remote acting, because you don't get to pal around and play with people. But I think the show came out just about as well as it could, and that was, of course, because of Bill.
Did he give you any kind of direction or anything? Like, when he gave you the script, did you have any kind of conversations about how it would go?
Not, I don't recall too much with that. I think he'd heard my audition, and he liked kind of the take on Carl, and I complimented him on coming up with a script that was very traditional, or are very, very true to the series. Let's put it that way. In fact, I think he even incorporated Petra Ivan might have been a reference to the first vampire in the first Night Stalker program, which was actually a made-for-TV movie that predated the series by 2 years. There were two made-for-TV movies and then a series that lasted all of one season, about 20 episodes. And he came up with this wonderful story where the vampires were going to rise up and take over the earth, and they had to have a sacrifice on sacred ground, which happened to be Wrigley Field in Chicago. And it was just exactly the kind of thing that the old Night Stalker series would have had. Interesting to note, and this is maybe kind of a down note, but there was supposed to be a second series. The first one, what was it? Playground for Evil, which was a four-part series that we did in 2009. He sent me a script, and I can't remember details off the top of my head, but I remember writing back to Bill and saying, look, Carl Kolchak, he wouldn't do this. I didn't particularly like the script, but I respected Bill enough to say, look, I will do this one episode for you, but going in, I just got to tell you, I don't think this is Carl. I don't think this really matches well with Carl's character. It seemed to me Bill had not written the script, that someone else had offered to do it, and Bill pulled the plug. He said, let's not do it. You know, if you're not behind it 100%, I don't want to do it. And I felt terrible. On the other hand, I felt like I did believe in what I said. That I don't recall the details now, but the script was not true to the character like Bill's had been, the first one had been. So I think it's probably just as well. But there was supposed to be a second Night Stalker, the Night Stalker Chronicle audio drama that, alas, never came to be. And it's my fault, so blame me.
That's totally Bill, where he really would, if somebody was not, if he trusted you enough to make you part of that cast, if you guys weren't into it, he would have said, okay, there's got to be a reason why, and we're not going to do this until it's right. Because he had that much respect for the people that he worked with, and obviously he had that much respect with what you guys were doing together in Kolchak. I have a little memory, has nothing to do with Bill, but the first time I've seen Kolchak the Night Stalker was at your house.
That's right. I'd forgotten that.
And I think that was before you actually did the show.
Yeah, it was that trip you took, that bicycle trip across Canada, or at least the Ontario section that's directly adjacent us here in International Falls.
With my father and my mother and my eldest son.
Yeah, and that was, you shocked me into action by saying you'd never seen an episode of The Night Stalker. Was it ever shown in Canada?
If it was, it wasn't shown at a time appropriate for me to watch as a kid. So I'm going to have to ask my parents because I'm actually going to see them next week. And I'll find out about that. But it'd be something worth looking into because I don't remember it being one of the go-to. I had heard of it through when I was older, but not when I was younger. Do you have any other last memories of Bill interactions that stick out in your mind?
Well, I think it just gets back to online. He was such a big presence. Not knowing too much about his personal life, it always struck me, good Lord, when does this man sleep? When does he work? How does he make a living? Because, as I say, he was always a very, very strict believer that we should not be doing this for money. Now, if a clearer path had appeared to where people could make a living doing audio drama, a path like I think maybe we're beginning to get the glimmer of right now, maybe he had changed his mind. But, you know, back, we're talking 5-6 years ago, there was nothing. If you were selling a little bit on Audible or selling a CD now and again, you were doing really good. But the thing I will always associate with Bill Holwig is the sound design, his ability to mix and put together effects in such a way. I mean, go back and listen to, of course, Frequency is still online, and the Kolchak Show is still online, and following this interview, you're going to play an episode, correct? Is that
we're going to play the Kolchak series for sure.
Pay special attention to the opening, because he had this way of taking an opening or taking a segment that maybe was familiar to fans in a visual medium and putting it into an audio-only medium that worked so well. Because the opening of the Night Stalker television show was Carl Kolchak coming into the office when it was dark and everyone was gone, sitting down at the typewriter and hammering out a story. And the way he tells that story with sound, he takes the time, you hear the footsteps, you hear, you know, Carl pour himself a cup of coffee and take a sip, and it's also crisp and mixed so beautifully that I honestly don't know what it would be like for someone who wasn't familiar with the show. For someone like me who is familiar with the show, it's just enchanting to hear that world brought to life with sound only. And I kind of wish, you know, with the X-Files making the jump to audio now, that maybe we could, you know, find a way to get a Night Stalker series going on Audible.com, because it's exactly the kind of show that I think has a lot of fans who would love to check it out, and there's just no end to those adventures. And even more so than X-Files, I would say, the Night Stalker series had such great characters, and Bill did such a great job of finding the people. You know, because like, well, Ralph Walters, the zombie astronaut for Tony Vincenzo, that was perfect, because Tony Vincenzo was sort of, he was the antagonist. He was the source of a lot of the humor, and you needed a guy in that role that really understood how to be funny, and that was Ralph.
Well, let's not waste another minute and get ourselves right to Kolchak. Thanks so much for coming in and speaking to us about Bill and your memories of Bill, and thanks so much for doing this show.
Well, thank you, Jack, for keeping, making sure that his legacy moves on and the internet moves on for the next generation. You're doing good work there.
Have a great night.
You too.
Hi, this is Paul Mannering, writer and producer for Broken Sea Audio. Over at BrokenSea.com, we produce all kinds of audio fiction. BrokenSea.com, resistance is fertile.
Hurry, hurry,
step right up.
The most
amazing tales appear
before your
very eyes,
gathered from
the four
corners of Earth and brought here to you
at 19
Nocturne Boulevard.
See
the famous
man-eating book of
Sumatra.
Or a phantom
direct
from merry old England.
Whoa!
Or aliens
from beyond
the star.
Even such as these cannot withstand our platinum death ray.
Yes, our platinum death ray!
All these and more
spread out
before you.
And all
we ask is a moment of your time.
Spin the wheel.
And make a chance.
Try your luck.
www.19nocturneboulevard.net.
My name is Carl Kolchak, former reporter for INS, Chicago's very own independent news service. In all my years of investigative journalism, I've seen some pretty strange things. Today, you'd simply look at them as amusing fodder for the national tabloids. But hear me out when I tell you that they're real. the vampires, androids, ghosts, swamp creatures, monkey men, and even Jack the Ripper. Yes, every last one. Rather than jeopardize my former editor's sanity with such sensational tales, I simply left out the details for public consumption. Oh, I kept the real transcripts, conveniently tucked away from the curious eye, in a file under the innocuous name All Saints Archive. But now, happily retired, I believe I can finally release the full accounts, as I actually experienced them. Prepare yourself now for one of many cases from the All Saints Archive, or as I call them, the Night Stalker incidents. This night's tale, Playground for Evil, Episode 1. Chicago, night. An hour before closing time for the Chicago party scene, Bergalli's Emporium, swank ritzy bar for the jet set where a glass of water alone costs $5. The playground for the offspring of the rich, powerful, political, and famous of Chicago. And tonight, a playground for evil.
Rita, darling, would you stay? The party is just getting started. Petri has eyes for you both.
Petri can go take a flying. Oh, what's the use? Monique and I have to go. Right, Monique?
But Rita,
Petri is so... We're going now.
Fine. I'm going.
I have your purse and already paid your tab.
Stop pushing.
Monique.
It's like when we were kids at Winnecke Elementary. Always gotta do what Rita wants. I bet.
Monique, grow up. Bye, Annette. Kisses to the family.
Ta-ta. Bartender, another wolfy hall banger. Oops, did I say bang her?
If her tatas hung out any farther from the red scrap of cloth she calls a dress, she'd make a slimy fortune pole dancing at truck stops. Oh, come on, Monique. Petri is a bore.
Fine. Oh, my God. It's so cold.
It's October.
Rita, you have to admit, Petri is cute. In an old-fashioned European kind of way.
If you liked Harry Palmed Romanians.
Yeah, but did you see his tushy?
If you brought him home to your father, he'd have a coronary and you'd be stuck running INS. Why, your father makes you work as an intern at his newspaper. Taxi!
Well, it's like he always says, one day, I'll turn this paper over to you, kitten. You need to know the nuts and bolts of your heritage.
What a heritage. But your family does live well, though how you put up with that reporter, what's his name, Carl? Where's a taxi when you need it? Taxi!
Oh, for the love of... Oh, my God.
Monique Marblestein.
Oh, Petri.
You and your friend, Miss Rollingston, left so soon. Taxis are hard to come by this late. Might I offer you both a lift? My chauffeur is around the corner.
Oh, yes, Mr. Ivan.
Please, call me Prince Petrie. Or just Petrie, if you like.
Great. Just great, Monique. It's raining.
It is starting to rain.
Thank you, Prince.
Join me.
Petrie, but no, not tonight, not ever. Look, a cab. Come on, Monique. Sorry, Petrie, but you and your hairy Romanian palms will have to find someone else to grope this evening. Driver, 4151 Lakeshore Drive, now!
Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry, Petrie, but Rita's my friend, and I have to work, and I'll see you around, okay?
But of course, you will see me around.
In! Oof! Come on, get in!
Why are you such a
driver? Step on it!
I got it!
But Rita, you're so cute!
You, Rita Rollingston.
Adrak!
We have another stop before retiring this night.
Yes, Master.
And Adrak, is Annette safely tucked away in the trunk?
As he commanded.
Good. I'm famished. Let us depart. But the slight detour to Lakeshore Drive.
Lakeshore Drive, Chicago, October 22nd, 1973. A clear day, but the cold was starting to blow in from Lake Michigan. Though it would grow no colder for Rita Rollingston, age 24, socialite, model, and now transplant donor for Gordy the Ghoul, mortician and bookie dealing in betting on corpse statistics at the morgue. Who needs to track with Gordy around? I can't put Gordy in this. He's helped me too much in the past. And he still owes me money from the last bet. I'll mark that down on my calendar. First time Gordy has to pay Carl Kolchak. My luck must be changing. Okay, Rita Rollingston, who's 24, socialite, model, and now bloodless victim of a serial murderer. She was found at her penthouse, 44151 Lakeshore Drive, drained of all her blood after, or possibly before, a fall from 30 stories. This reporter wonders if the term vamp...
Oh, for Pete's sake, Tony, I'm working on a Pulitzer here!
A Pulitzer! Emily!
Yes, Mr. Vincenzo?
You don't drink coffee. You drink green tea. Are you getting Kolchak his coffee? I pay you to write an advice column for INS, not to get Carl Kolchak coffee.
Tony, that was my...
coffee, which is now in the trash can. Like your story, if you keep writing about... Emily, I need it. Essence.
But Mr. Vincenzo, been talking with Carl this morning. He's so nice,
no,
you know.
No, not you too. Carl, what did you do to Emily?
Tony, I take affront at your vile accusation.
You can't even spell affront, Carl. Well, Emily?
I just seem to think that Carl's story does seem to point to the possibility of a creature of the night.
It's a conspiracy. Look at me. Miss Emily. Cowles. Pay attention here! Antacids. Emily. Antacids. Now!
Yes, sir, Mr. Vincenzo.
Emily, here's $5. Thanks for trying.
You said 10.
Can I until Saturday?
You can take my granddaughter on a date.
Here, 10. Swindled by a co-worker.
Bertha Ray will be so displeased.
Are you two through? Miss Cowell. My ulcer. Antacids. Remember? Now!
Yes, sir, Mr. Vincenzo.
Look, Tony, not only are you going to have yourself another heart attack, but you saw yourself that dearest Emily believes me. Don't you, Emily?
Don't, Carl.
I asked for a column on a murder. And what do I hear when I come into the INS bullpen? Boris Karloff.
I think you mean Bela Lugosi. Count
Don't say
Karloff
it.
Karloff was the Frankenstein's monster.
I don't care.
Look,
Tony, I never said...
Because I cut you off halfway through the word.
Tony. What else could have drained poor Rita Rollingston of all her white and red blood cells?
Don't say it.
Other than a genuine blood-sucking venom.
Don't say the V word. Ever. Not around me. Not in the office. Don't think it. Don't write it. Don't eat garlic bread. Where the hell is Emily and my antacids?
Tony, you have to listen to me. I have an angle.
An angle? You! Carl, it's you!
Me?
Yes, you! It's you, Carl. And your dirty straw hat. And your white rumpled suit. It's you! You give me heartburn! You're trying to kill me!
Me!
Yes, you!
Now, Tony, if you would just let me report the facts.
Yes, Kolchak! Facts would be nice! For once without...
Hold that thought, phone. Tony, you really ought to consider therapy.
What? I don't know why I... Kolchak's trying to kill me! My life for a Rolade!
Tony, the public, on the phone.
Carl, shh.
Yes, this is Carl Kolchak, INS reporter. Mm-hmm. Really? You don't say. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Carl.
You know, your voice is familiar somehow. Is that, I get that a lot, too. This is strange.
Carl?
I would think so, Miss...
We are going to talk, Carl, soon.
Shh.
Where is Emily?
Really?
What do I pay you people for?
Tony, you don't say.
Pardon me, Mr.
Vincenzo? What? Monique, why, you are almost, but not quite, on time.
Really?
I don't care who your father is. Heartburn, you all give me... Do I get them? No.
Pardon me, Miss...
Morning, Monique.
Great night.
Yes, Mr. Kolchak.
Yes,
with my friend Rita.
Did you say Rita?
Boss's daughter shows up at noon. My Aunt S is our AWOL. And all I have is Kolchak. And another one of
Vampire his... Vampire exclusives,
I'm
Tony.
Carl. Sorry I'm late, Mr. Vincenzo, but my father said it would be okay.
Did we say something wrong, Tony?
Yeah, with Rita. It was a long night at Begali's Emporium.
Now that's a ritzy joint, Monique. Hold that thought. I'm on the phone. Breaking news. Oh, that? Oh, I know that was my editor. No. He's giving me the hearty Italian thumbs up because I'm his ace reporter. Now tell me again about this acquaintance of yours and his nightly unnatural habits. And you say you live on Lakeshore Drive. Right? Next door to the deceased. Oh, really? And your name is Lilith Cordescu? That's with a K? No, a C. Okay. Well, I'll be over.
Lakeshore Drive.
2 o'clock. Okay, 2 o'clock. We'll be fine. Thank you, Miss. Of course. Lilith.
Well, what happened at Lakeshore Drive?
Call me Carl. See you this afternoon. Goodbye. At 2. ciao.
What happened on Lakeshore Drive?
Murder. Look, gotta run. I have to stop at the morgue to meet Lilith on that hot lead. Where's my... tape recorder. Thank you.
You know, I have a friend who lives on Lakeshore Drive.
Geez, my Mustang needs an oil change. What? Oh, it happened on the 44-100 block off Lakeshore Drive. You can tell me about your soiree when I get back.
Never been invited to Bergali's.
Do you need any help on this scoop? He still wants me to become a journalist, you know.
Wonderful. Not again.
Got a dash. Talk about that sometime. Bye.
Mr. Kolchak.
Glad to see you're back from Brooklyn.
Rita lives at 44151 Lakeshore Drive. I need to give her a call.
Where is Kolchak? Monique, find Carl. No, forget that. Find Emily and my AWOL antacids! Now!
Oh, yes, sir, Mr. Vincenzo.
Interns.
Where am I? I feel... drained. Dark. Oh, God, it's dark here. I'm still here. Dungeon. Who is it? Help. Help me, please.
Annette, you are awake.
and feisty as ever.
I don't know who you are, but my daddy is rich.
We'll not miss his spoiled debutante of a daughter. Your blood is rich. But that is not why you are here, Annette. Though it did please me to taste the fount of your life.
What are you? Some kind of vampire?
I am, and I am not. But that is such a pedestrian name for the children of the night.
Let me go.
Let us just say that I have made a pact with
somebody else.
Forces. And those...
Let me go.
How shall I say this delicately? Require payment for their services to me.
What?
In flesh.
They let me go. Stay away. Help somebody else.
I could pay them with my flesh.
Let me go.
Or yours.
What?
I choose the latter.
Stay away. Help somebody!
Andrek, the serrated cutlery will do.
What? Somebody help! Let me go! Let me go! Stay back!
I do so enjoy your spirit, Annette. But even feisty things must come to their ultimate end. Nespa?
What are you going to do?
Thank you, Andrek. You don't know, Annette?
No!
I am so sorry. In exchange for immeasurable power over certain of my Nosferatu kin...
What are you going to do?
I am going to flay you.
No! Stay back!
And sacrifice your skin to the Lord of Ghouls.
All the way down here because I want it fair and square.
You still owe me for all the Saturdays you said you'd pay when you didn't win, stretching back to the dawn of recorded time.
Funny, Gordy. Look, does a city medical examiner make enough to send 3 kids through college? No. All these trips of mine to the city morgue and this racket of yours are putting your kid through school, Gordy, and me in the poorhouse. Be nice to your bank, Gordy.
Bank that has no money? What'd you want, Carl?
Well, I...
Information on who now?
Rita Rollinson, 24 years old. She fell out of,
Lakeview Drive, right? Brunette.
Yeah, that's her. I need to know if she... I still have to pay the pot. Gordy, that's highway robbery. You owe me!
We've covered that.
Fine. $5?
50.
50? Have you been smoking the formaldehyde? How about... How about... $23.36.
Rest on your tab.
Gordy.
My youngest needs braces.
You're going to need braces on your legs.
What was that, Carl?
Fine. Here. Now, was Miss Rollinson drained of all her blood before she took the fall?
Yes. Strange case. She should have been a mushy mess. Sack of potato chips after a fall like that. But no blood and no broken bones.
What?
See for yourself. See, Carl? What the hell?
What? She looks alive.
No, she's not alive, but her contusions have healed.
Do you have any garlic and a steak?
What?
I'm serious, Gordy. Give me a wooden table leg, a yard dart, something.
Are you insane?
I've seen this before. She is a vampire.
Gordy, we found another one, like the Rita case. Name's Annette Bennett. Played and drained of blood and, skinned. I've never seen anything like it. The wagon's on the way here. You! What are you doing in the city morgue?
Captain Mad Dog Siska, how the heck are you? Annette Bennett, you say? She was skinned. You mean like flayed?
That's confidential police business.
Another one like Rita Rollinson? Tell me more.
On second thought, I don't want to know why you're here, Kolchak. Forget I said anything. In fact, O'Brien.
Yes, sir.
Impound Kolchak's camera, tape recorder, and anything else he has.
What? Yes, sir. Kolchak.
Oh! You!
This is against the law. Hey, I paid for...
Though I sincerely doubt it, there may be evidence on there of a crime, or at the very least, yet more evidence of your stupidity, which should be a crime. Get him out of here, O'Brien.
Move it, Kolchak.
I am filing a formal protest. Let go.
I'll let you keep that god-awful hat, Kolchak.
My arm.
Don't make me have to arrest you for violating the good taste of Chicago. And notice how non-stressed I am. The anger management classes have done wonders. Why, in the old days, I would have just bashed you over the head with my nightstick. Oh, I miss those days. Get him out of here, O'Brien.
Move it, Kolchak.
Hey, my suit, O'Brien. Captain, you're going to need a wooden... stakes for Rita Rawlingston.
Kolchak.
What the hell was he talking about? Wooden stakes?
You don't want to know.
I need to call my therapist.
After having my camera and tape recorder impounded, I ran by the bank, found I was overdrawn, ran back to the office, borrowed an advance from Emily. Tony was locked in his office, eating antacid like gumdrops. Note to self, now I have a date with Emily's granddaughter, Bertha Ray. Saturday night. Great. Anyway, went to Sears and replaced said impounded camera and tape recorder, and I was running late for my appointment with Lilith. Though I did get some valuable information from Mad Dog Siska of the Chicago PD. A second murder, a second drained body, and soon-to-be vampire in the city morgue that I was going to have to do something about. Oh, what a day. Great, stoplight. Something keeps... Rita. The name Rita keeps popping into my head. Beyond the obvious choice of dead socialite model, but for the life of me, I can't remember why or who said her name. And how does the mysterious Lilith fit into all this? Damn my stoic. Come on, green! Finally! Hope Lilith is still home.
Mr. Kolchak, you are late.
Sorry about that, Miss Cardescu. Long story, murders, captains of Chicago's finest in need of anger management. You know the kind. Been a long day. May I come?
Please do.
Thanks. Wow. Big place. It echoes, and it's real dark.
Dark as the pit, some might say.
You said you had some information, Lilith. Can't see my hand in front of my face here.
Face?
Ah, you're right next to me. And the fire started all on its own. Nice trick. Look, Lilith.
Seat, Mr. Kolchak. Come.
Yeah. Nice gothic decor.
Thank you. Do you like my dress?
Huh? What? Oh my. Yeah. Well, you are gorgeous. Sorry, I don't know what's gotten into me.
Thank you. Drink?
Drink. Yes. No. I don't know. I look, why am I here, Lilith? What do you know about the bloodless murders?
A great deal. Have a drink, and we will talk. Here.
Thank you, I think.
Petri Ivan. You know of him?
Yes. Yes, owner of a large steel foundry in, I think, some kind of royalty, Romanian. A prince, maybe.
A vampire.
He's the one that's...
Yes, but there is more. He has forsaken his birthright and joined an unholy necromantic circle of vampiric outcasts. They have forsaken the Elder Order and pledged allegiance to the ghouls.
The ghouls? We're serious.
Serious as the crypts.
And this means...
He's been granted dark powers. Ominous dark powers to seek revenge on the Elder Vampiric Order. The power of the ghouls.
This is bad, right?
Yes. The atrocities and sacrifices to the dark gods come across the Well of Beyond will only intensify, Mr. Kochak. It is bad indeed.
But how do I know you are telling the truth?
You saw Rita Rorenstein at the city morgue, did you not?
Yes, but...
Then you already suspect. I simply confirm.
But how do you know all this?
Why, Mr. Kochak, I thought you knew. I also...
Thank you for listening to Broken Sea Audio's Kolchak, the Night Stalker. Starring in Kolchak, the Night Stalker, Jeffrey Adams from the Icebox Radio as the man, the myth, the legend, Carl Kolchak, and Ralph W. Walters from the Zombie Astronauts Frequency of Fear as Tony Vincenzo, M. Ciro Garcia starred as Monique Marmelstein, Julie Hooverson of 19 Nocturne Boulevard starred as Emily, Gareth Preston of Westlake Films starred as Petri Ivan, the vampire. Stevie Farnaby, known for Escape from New York and Maudlin, starred as Petri Ivan's sidekick and Gollum on track. Christy Plotkin starred as Lilith Cordescu. Paul Lavelle of Gaia fame starred as police captain Mad Dog Siska. Stevie Farnaby also starred as the cab driver. Elaine Barrett of Gaia's Voyages starred as Rita Rollinson. Gwendolyn Jensen Woodard of Gypsy Audio starred as Annette and Beb Lestrange. And Taylor Kent of the Snark Tank podcast starred as Gordy, the ghoul spangler, the mortician. And Doug Manlin, the man, the myth, the slam dancer, starred as Officer O'Brien. I would also like to thank Brian of Serac Panoply, composed the remixed version of the Kolchak theme, as well as some other bits and pieces. And Peter Wicks of Westlake Films for some incidental music. This is a fan tribute to Kolchak the Night Stalker, the original series from the 70s. An original story written by Bill Holwood, intro composed by Mark Kalita, based on characters created by the author Grant Rice. No copyright infringement is intended. All music, themes, and characters are the copyright of their respective owners. For more shows, check out www.brokensea.com.
In the 26th century, Earth thrives after recovering from nearly total ecological catastrophe. To prevent similar disasters from happening on other worlds, Earth and the Galactic Confederation built a massive interstellar ark, the Zooship Gaia. Commanded by Captain Elizabeth Monroe, Gaia's mission is to protect wildlife and habitats on worlds throughout the galaxy. These are their adventures. There are heroes.
The galaxy is full of bad guys, and in order to take out the trash, you have to be willing to get your hands dirty.
Ooh, see, sense, woman! Why do you always have to do things the hard way?
There are villains.
You will all feel my wrath very soon!
We are the stuff of nightmares. We're all that civilized races fear in the dark.
And there are those somewhere in between.
I am an assassin, woman. I am the assassin of assassins. I'm not a dog to grovel at your feet.
I never ask anyone to grovel. That would be uncivilized.
In season one of Gaia's Voyages, these forces collide. And the fate of Gaia and her crew stands on the edge of a Vanjari blade. Broken Sea Audio Productions presents Gaia's Voyages, only at www.brokensea.com.
Since March 2007, one online audio production group has pushed the boundaries.
Broken Sea Audio Productions presents Maudlin.
It's Sounding Board. Audio drama with Lumpy Bits.
You have been listening to Jake Sanson.
Broken Sea Audio Productions presents
My name is Feedback, and these are my stories.
Last time on Gaia's Voyages.
This is the Broken Sea Audio production of Escape from New York.
OTR Swag Cast.
Doctor Who, starring Mark Kalita as the Doctor.
BrokenSea.com. New audio every Thursday.
I am bored.
Why even talk about it?
Because there is nothing in my life but the wine and this little bistro.
Surely there must be something we can do. We are, after all, French.
Mais oui. But there is nothing entertaining in the whole patio world. Where, oh where will I get my feel of good radio drama? The art! She's... Le date.
But no, my little gumdrop sugar baguette. There is the Sonic Society.
The Society? I belong to the most exclusive clubs in all Paris. Why have I not heard of this Society?
They allow everyone to join.
Everyone? How bourgeois.
No, it is true. I assure you, as I am French.
Where is this Society?
They can be heard each week at sonicsociety.org and have the very best in new radio drama from around the world each week.
Say it is not how you say so.
Mais oui.
Jacques.
Yes, my little papillon de la unicorn.
I am beginning to lose my boredom.
Do not worry. Have another glass of wine.
Thank goodness.
I know.
Upper West Side, Chicago, dusk. In a gothic crypt, a lacquered casket containing an undead fiend lies on a cold stone floor, deep under the mansion of Romanian prince Petri Ivan.
Night falls again. And I hunger. The hunger of the immortal.
Andrak!
Yes, master.
My golem, I hunger for blood and for the power I deserve.
The limousine is ready. Master?
Yes?
I return to the abode of Rita Rollingstone as per your will.
And? Was there any trace of mine?
No, master. But a journalist arrived as I was leaving.
What journalist?
The one with the stories from the International News Service.
He destroyed my mindless Nosferatu minion in Hollywood a few years ago. He needs to be dealt with.
Should I,
No. He is too high profile to have questions raised by an untimely demise. But we will send a warning to that fool.
My name is Carl Kolschak, former reporter for INS, Chicago's very own independent news service. In all my years of investigative journalism, I've seen some pretty strange things. Today, you'd simply look at them as amusing fodder for the national tabloids. But hear me out when I tell you that they're real. The vampires, androids, ghosts, swamp creatures, monkey men, and even Jack the Ripper. Yes, every last one. Rather than jeopardize my former editor's sanity with such sensational tales, I simply left out the details for public consumption. Oh, I kept the real transcripts, conveniently tucked away from the curious eye, in a file under the innocuous name All Saints Archive. But now, happily retired, I believe I can finally release the full accounts, as I actually experienced them. Prepare yourself now for one of many cases from the All Saints Archive, or as I call them, the Night Stalker incidents. This night's tale, Playground for Evil, Episode 2. Outside of Chicago, night. A black limousine prowls like a devilish shark seeking prey through one of Chicago's roughest neighborhoods. And prey it finds.
Andrek.
Master?
Andrek. The bloodlust is upon me, and I have not the time to be discerning. There, she will do.
Yes, master.
You know that I'm loving you. In a god of a Vita, baby, don't you know that I'll always be true.
Your lady
need a
right. Tall dark. Oh, that fabulous train give you a trip, darling. Only money, baby. And by the looks of that black limo, your boss has that cup.
Money? Master has.
Master? That's real kinky, baby.
Master has needs. Yes, come.
Tell Master that costs extra. Ah! Hey, Lego, why you stop? Oh,
Master, she's
stop
now.
My arm. No. Help. No, don't. Please. Help. No.
Thank you.
Don't. Please. Let me out. Let me out. Let me out.
Quaint name. What? Mademoiselle Lestrange. Fitting, really. Pardon me. I am Petri Alba.
So what, freak? Let me out! Let me
no.
My arm! Let go! Your hands are so cold!
I am terribly sorry. But you see, I hunger. For I am
a burger, you son of a
vampire!
What? No! Get back! No!
Take my hand. In a garb of freedom, honey. Don't you know that I'm loving you? In a garb of freedom, baby. Don't you know that I'll always be true?
Oh, hey, Emily. I'm back. Oh, finally. I finally found Mr. Vincenzo some Rolades. I had to drive halfway across town. Oh my god, almost into Jersey for crying out loud. He bought up all the stock for blocks, I swear.
Thank you, dearie, for getting Mr. Vincenzo his NS this morning. I so did need to get to that yarn sale at the Blue Lady Giftcraft Mall over near the L. I just have to knit a sweater for Carl. He so needs someone to take care of him with winter just around the corner.
Oh, no problem, Emily. Not at all. Because that's what interns are for.
You really should go out with Carl, you know, dearie. Though he is a bit strange, he's a good man. Believes in his stories no matter what Mr. Vincenzo thinks.
Well, you know, my father might frown on being... I mean, being that my father owns INS and Mr. Kolchak, and Mr. Kolchak and I are, you know, co-workers, employees, constituents, if you will. I don't want to stir that pot, because co-worker, it's just, you know, that's it. It's just, not kosher, you know, it's not gonna work.
Even I sometimes have trouble believing in them.
Come on, Rita.
Androids and vampires and the like.
Come on, Rita.
But you know, Carl. I myself prefer to write my advice column.
Where are you?
And all that garlic he keeps in his desk. My, what a smell.
Where? Oh, for the love of... Just answer.
Who is it you're calling, dearie?
My friend, Rita Rorington.
Rita? Why? Oh, dear me, dear. Oh, dear me. Dear me. I'm so sorry.
Sorry? What's wrong, Rita? Answer. Wait, she's not answering. And you look white as a sheet. And why are you so... Why?
I don't know.
Why are you...
I'm
sorry.
Don't know how to tell you, Monique, but...
What? Just tell me.
Emily! Monique, what are you doing sitting at Kolchak's desk? Emily, did Carl give me the story of that girl? What was her name?
Mr. Vincenzo, no!
What? The one in the 44-100 block, Rita Rolling Rock.
Rita Rollingston. We've known each other for...
That's the one, Rita Rollingstone, murdered this morning.
What? No!
Mr. Vincenzo!
What?
No, it can't be.
Your friend was murdered this morning.
Rita, not Rita. It can't be Rita.
You knew Rita? Kolchak's investigating now. Maybe you could.
Mr. Vincent, what? Have a heart. A friend just passed on. Shame on you for thinking business at a time like this. Is that any way for the editor of INS to act?
What? What I say?
Rita, no. God, help.
There, dear. I am so sorry.
Where the hell is Kolchak?
Lakeshore Drive, Chicago, the apartment of one Lilith Cordescu, the same beautiful Miss Cordescu, who had called me, Carl Kolchak, out of the blue at my office at International News Service, INS for short, with information pertaining to the recent murder of model socialite Rita Rollingston, the same Rita Rollingston who was found earlier this brisk October morning, drained of all her blood, and thrown to the street from a 30-story apartment complex. The same Rita Rollingston who just so happened to have lived a few doors down from Lilith Cordescu's humble Gothic abode, before she caught a case of the terminal charity, taking the horrific form of blood donation to person or persons unknown, followed shortly thereafter by a test of Newton's laws governing gravitational acceleration, and its grisly results. I was not having one of my better days, and had still not gotten a cup of coffee. And here I was, passed out inside the Gothic abode of the aforementioned inhumanely gorgeous Lilith Cordescu, who, it just so happens, was also a vampire.
My nose.
Mr. Kolchak, you fell from your chair.
My nose.
You broke your nose.
Huh?
You have slept here on my divan.
Huh?
Passed out for hours.
Passed out? My, oh.
Ow. Slowly, do not try to get up fast.
My nose. That's not going to help my looks. What time is it?
Night. 8:45 p.m.
It was 2:30 when I got here. Who are you? Beautiful. You're beautiful. But I don't... Wait. Wait a minute. Get back.
You have cut yourself. Your head bleeds. Allow me to.
Damn it. Stay back, an undead creature. Or I will...
You will what?
I'll this!
You make a crucifix with your fingers to stop moi. Whatever shall I do, Mr. Kolchak? Come now, Mr. Kolchak. Allow me to bind and clean your wound. I promise I have no ulterior motive for obtaining your blood. If I had wanted to taste of your life's essence, you would already be dead. So let us drop this charade. Come, I won't bite.
Okay, I don't suppose I have much choice, do I?
No. Allow me to assist.
Oh, you're strong. Ow. You picked me up like a rag doll.
I am a vampire. You really are bleeding from that cut on your head. Come.
Oh, okay. Vampires have bathrooms?
We do not all reside in the Carpathian Mountains, holding court in the cobwebs and crumbling monuments to times past. Here, allow me to clean your wound.
Yeah! Oh! Ow!
Don't be a baby.
Yeah!
Master, The incantations are ready. The pentacle scored in virginal blood has been prepared in the pit.
Andrek, my trusted golem. I do so enjoy a warm fire. It keeps the chill on my undead bones at bay. The girl, Annette, has she been fully played?
Per your instructions, Master.
Good. Bring the other victims' skins to the pit. I must prepare mentally for the rites of hell to come, Nespa.
Yes, my master.
The ghouls will not wait long. I will need a second Nosferatu slave to terrorize this town. 3 days hence, Miss Rollingston should be awakening to her new unlife, hungry for blood. Hiding the true darkness that I now bring. Lilith Codescu and her vampire cabal will rue the day they cross swords with Petri Ivan.
...10:30 p.m. headed back to INS. Having had my wounds cleaned and dressed by a vampire, Miss Cordescu, and not having my blood forcibly removed from my neck by Lilith, and I checked, note to self, vampires do not have reflections in mirrors, and in the future, remember not to use my fingers as crucifix.
Hey! Whoa! What do you think this is, New York? Learn to drive, idiot!
Damn, where else think they own the road? Foreign dignitary flags on it. From Romania. It's a bell. It's a bell. Need to check on the Romanian flag when I get back. Here we are. Oh, parking up that spot. It's closer. They try to insane.
Carl, where have you... What the hell happened to your face? It's uglier than usual.
Funny, Tony. No time for Italian wisecracks now. I'll have you know I'm onto the story of the century.
What now? Damn, did I mention you look awful? You haven't gotten beaten up by police captain Siska again, have
Funny,
you?
Tony, bear the laughs. No mad dog Siska has not floated like a butterfly on me today.
More like where? Stung what? Like a thousand pound bee.
Funny, Tony.
What are you looking for?
A book on honors and customs of Romania. Where is the... No. I knew it. See, Petri Ivan's diplomatic flag, which just so happens to adorn a specific black limo that tried to run me off the road on the way over here.
What are you... What's that?
Sounds like Chicago's finest star. Pulling up here.
What'd you do now, Carl?
Not me, I swear. Scout's honor called me. Oh, come on. Let's go see what's happening.
Right behind you, Kolchak. But if you had anything to do with this, I'm not bailing you out again.
Tony, would I do that to you? Again?
Shut up, Carl, and get downstairs. Squad cars everywhere, Carl!
Yeah, look over there. The cops are gathered around something in the alley. Come on, though. With these pictures and my story, you'll have to put them on the front page.
Just don't get in the way, Carl. Be subtle.
Of course, Tony. It's me, Carl. Hey, my camera! Watch it! Watch out where you're going, officer.
Kolchak.
Captain Mad Dog Siska. Oops. Let me get that camera from you. I'll just take care of it.
You won't be eating that.
Subtle, Carl. Real subtle.
It looks, broken.
Did you see that abuse of power? Tony, did you?
Shut up, Carl. Captain Siska, I apologize for Kolchak.
There isn't enough oxygen in the world to apologize for Kolchak.
I heard that.
Shut up, Carl. So what's happened here?
Hell of a news organization you got here, Vincenzo. Body turns up skinned right outside your news offices, and a drunken bum finds the mess and calls the cops.
Oh, my God. What is that nailed to her
Forehead. It looks like a picture of you, Carl.
Why would...
That's what I was about to ask you, Colchak.
Thank you for listening to Broken Sea Audio's Colchak, the Night Stalker. Starring in Colchak, the Night Stalker, Jeffrey Adams from the Icebox Radio as the man, the myth, the legend, Carl Colchak, and W. Ralph Walters from the Zombie Astronauts Frequency of Fear as Tony Vincenzo, and starring as Monique Marmelstein, the amazing M. Sierra Garcia. Julie Hooverson of 19 Nocturne Boulevard starred as Emily. Gareth Preston of Westlake Films starred as Petri Ivan, the vampire. Stevie Farnaby, known for Escape from New York and Maudlin, starred as Petri Ivan's sidekick and Gollum on track. Christy Plotkin starred as Lilith Cordescu. Paul Lavelle of Gaia fame starred as police captain Mad Dog Siska. Stevie Farnaby also starred as the cab driver. Elaine Barrett of Gaia's Voyages starred as Rita Rollingston. Gwendolyn Jensen Woodard of Gypsy Audio starred as Annette and Beb Lestrange. And Taylor Kent of the Snark Tank Podcast starred as Gordy, the Ghoul Spangler, the Mortician. And Doug Manlin, the man, the myth, the slam dancer, starred as Officer O'Brien. I would also like to thank Brian of Seraph Panoply, composed the remixed version of the Colchak theme, as well as some other bits and pieces. And Peter Wicks of Westlake Films for some incidental music. This is a fan tribute to Colchak the Night Stalker, the original series from the 70s. Original story written by Bill Holwood, intro composed by Mark Kalita, based on characters created by the author Grant Rice. No copyright infringement is intended. All music, themes, and characters are the copyright of their respective owners. For more shows, check out www.brokensea.com.
Without warning, they came from the sky. Creatures, similar in origin, yet so very different from us.
Commander Taylor, the ship is now entering the belt of Orion Quadrant.
Wonderful.
Time has come for...
I'm getting there. Space. So ends my last signal until we reach our destination.
We called them ignorant. Savages. Until one day, one of the beasts spoke.
Taylor! Why'd you run away?
Security police, Dr. Zira.
I'm in charge of this man.
No longer, Dr. Zira. He is now in my custody. General Ursus.
Get your stinking paws off me, you damn dirty ape!
Taylor!
And the teachings of our great lawgiver were called into question.
Beware the beast man, for he is the devil's paw. Let him not breed in great numbers, or he will make a desert of his home and yours. Shun him, for he is the harbinger of death.
Indeed, we learned the truth, and we exposed what had for many generations been forbidden. The man-beast also possessed an intellect, one that made him all the more dangerous.
Praise the Alpha.
Bless the Omega.
Praise the wisdom of the bomb.
Praise the wisdom of the bomb.
Join us once again as Broken Sea Audio Productions takes you beyond the imagination into the land beneath the Planet of the Apes. Adapted and expanded from the original script by Paul Denn and Mort Abrams, based on the world created by Pierre Boulle. Only at BrokenSea.com.
Since March 2007, one online audio production group has pushed the boundaries.
Broken Sea Audio Productions presents Maudlin.
It's sounding boring. Audio drama with lumpy bits.
You have been listening to Jake Sampson.
Broken Sea Audio Productions presents
My name is Feedback, and these are my stories.
Last time on Gaia's Voyages.
This is the Broken Sea Audio production of Escape from New York.
OTR Swagcast.
Doctor Who, starring Mark Telita as the Doctor.
BrokenSea.com. New audio every Thursday.
Download complete. The Icebox Radio Theater is now your home for
mystery.
Tales of mystery, tales of suspense. All original, all the time.
What's that?
What's what?
Something's over there.
Visit iceboxradio.org for CDs, downloadable MP3s, information on coming attractions, and more.
Do I frighten you, little girl?
On the World Wide Web at www.iceboxradio.org.
Upper West Side, Chicago, midnight. A black limousine slowly pulls up the long, tree-covered drive to the Gothic mansion on a hill. A dark manse where evil resides, and its master now returns.
Far too late this night. But our point has been made to Mr. Kolchak, I believe. Take the body of Miss Lestrange and bury her in the orchard. I must rest for the festivities to come. Andrek, after you have finished burying our Nosferatu to be, ensure that the pentangular blood is not disturbed in the And whilst I sleep, find Miss Marmelstein and do give her a clue as to how to find the gathering. For when next I awake from my casket, the rites of the ghouls shall be invoked, and Miss Marmelstein will be our special gift to the Dark Lord of the Ghouls.
As you will, Master.
Hell beckons Lilith Cordescu, and I will be its master, and you. And all your brood will all bow down before me.
My name is Carl Kolchak, former reporter for INS, Chicago's very own independent news service. In all my years of investigative journalism, I've seen some pretty strange things. Today, you'd simply look at them as amusing fodder for the national tabloids. But hear me out when I tell you that they're real. The vampires, androids, ghosts, swamp creatures, monkey men, and even Jack the Ripper. Yes, every last one. Rather than jeopardize my former editor's sanity with such sensational tales, I simply left out the details for public consumption. Oh, I kept the real transcripts, conveniently tucked away from the curious eye, in a file under the innocuous name All Saints Archive. But now, happily retired, I believe I can finally release the full accounts as I actually experienced them. Prepare yourself now for one of many cases from the All Saints Archive, or as I call them, the Night Stalker incidents. This night's tale, Playground for Evil, Episode 3. Started on Lakeshore Drive in Chicago, outside the apartment of one Lilith Cordescu, the same vampirus who has decided to help me for reasons I still cannot quite fathom. The same apartment complex where one Rita Rollinston was found drained of all her blood and hurled to her death from 30 stories. And according to the inhumanely beautiful yet quite undead Lilith Cordescu, it was not Miss Cordescu who committed said homicide, but was in fact one of her devilish brethren, who was the true murderer, slash fiend, slash vampire, slash suspect of my journalistic inquiry. Specifically, one Petri Ivan, a Romanian prince, and according to Miss Cordescu, a vampire, searching to make an unholy alliance with the unholy king of the ghouls here in Chicago. Why, you may ask? Petri Ivan has come to Chicago from his native homeland, overtly on a diplomatic business for them, but his real raison d'etre, he was here because of some sort of cosmic equinox or star alignment or something. Maybe the Cubs are destined to finally win the big one. In any event, something supernatural is happening here in our Windy City's night skies in the next few days. And according to Miss Cordescu, though she would elaborate no further, this cosmic event is to occur here in Chicago. Oddly enough, Lilith did go on at length while bandaging a head wound I suffered in her apartment, about a nail foundry located in Romania, owned no less by a certain family with the surname of Ivan. Anyway, what was I? Right. This cosmic occurrence will allow one Petri Ivan to obtain supreme powers of evil from the king of the ghouls. As hard as that is to believe, why? So Mr. Ivan of the Undead can start, for lack of a better term, a turf war with the more conservative elements of the vampire race? All in the name of vengeance, righting a wrong to his mind, as it were, committed by the aforementioned Miss Lilith Cordescu ages ago. But I have other problems of my own at this juncture, namely that a body formerly alive and female, now fully dead, and, well, still female, had been found right outside my INS office, skinned, with a picture of me nailed to her forehead. And Police Captain Mad Dog Siska wanted to know why. Did I also mention that I'm pretty sure that the dead Rita Rawlingston is probably undead? In any event, here I sit with my editor Tony Vincenzo in an interrogation room of Chicago's finest, in custody.
And still no coffee!
Spill it, Kolchak. Now. And, for the record, my anger management therapist is out of town. And I'm feeling a bit... like the old Mad Dog right this minute.
Look, Captain Siska, for Pete's sake, I don't have a clue why my photo was nailed to the dead girl's forehead. Honest! Tony, tell him!
Carl, I was wondering about that myself!
Tony!
So you have no idea, not even a hint, as to why someone would, A, skin a poor 20-something girl, B, then kill said skinned girl, and finally, C, nail your photo to her head? I would have thought, all things being equal, this maniac would have skinned you, Kolchak. But that's wishful thinking, I suppose.
Real funny. While we're on the subject, Captain Siska, exactly how old did you say that nail was that was used to pin my mug to the, deceased?
I didn't.
What in blue blazes has that to do with anything, Carl?
Yes, Kolchak. I would love to know why you are so interested in that, too.
Okay, fine. While we're doing some background checks on my story on the Rita Rawlingston murder...
Carl, how does this tie in with the Rawlingston case?
Just listen, Tony. Eat an antacid, meditate, do some yoga or something, but let me finish.
Carl!
You see, after running into the fine Captain Siska here at the Rita Rawlingston crime scene...
I should have just arrested you then, Kolchak. I'd save money on my therapist's tab.
Yeah. Anyway, after leaving the murder scene, I was nearly run off the road by the limousine of one Petri Ivan, a limousine bearing a diplomatic flag and immunity that goes along with it. After a small bit of research on Mr. Ivan's history, I would hazard to guess that the nail in question dates back to the 16th century.
What the hell?
Captain, to autopsy report.
Thanks, Brian. Let's see what the coroner said. Huh. No? She was skinned. Nail is from a foundry in... Holy sh...
Huh? I was right.
But how
one
did you...
One of the family's holdings dating back to the 16th century and up to the present day was...
A foundry in Coventry Works in Romania. I read about that somewhere. They at one time produced all the nails and carpentry supplies for most of Transylvania. And, well, Eastern Europe.
You do read my stories, Tony. Now, as for how Mr. Ivan is tied up with all this, I'll be more than happy to work with you for an exclusive.
What?
Now, Captain Siska, I promise to share any leads I get with you the second I get them myself. Otherwise, I'll stay here. A happy charge of the state, making a nuisance of myself daily, just to make sure you don't forget about little old me.
Carl, I warned you. INS is not bailing you out again.
Shut up, Vincenzo. And as for you, Kolchak, I don't know where you got this information. And I don't want to know how. And don't, under any circumstances, mention garlic or wooden stakes or monsters roaming my city streets.
Francisca, I was just going to warn them that...
Can it. Don't want to know. Don't care.
What? What's the use of...
Got it?
I got it.
Good. Look, Kolchak, I'm going to let you go. Why? Because you are a pain. A pain with a capital P. With the understanding. Contact me on any new occurrences, leads, anything of value. But no monster hocus pocus crap. Got me? Or I bury you under my office. With your boss.
I got it.
Carl, if we survive this without losing our right to vote...
I know, I'm fired. But until then, we're a team.
Where the hell are my Rolaids? Why, Carl? Why? God, these things are awful without water.
What a day. Well, free again, at last. Anyway, I dropped Tony off at the INS office with a carton of antacids. I keep them handy for him, just in case you understand. And headed for the city morgue for the second time in 12 hours, just to make sure Gordy was all right. Silver cross, wooden stake, and hammer in tow.
Just because I had a feeling.
My family's always been healthy. Oh, a touch of constipation now and then. But we've got X-Lax for that.
Let's meet at the office just once! Gordy! Jeez! Oh, I knew it! Yeah! What is that? Gordy!
Jack, help!
Yeah! What in...
Who is this? I said, mortal.
Yeah! I could see that. Where did I put my steak?
That wooden steak will do you little good cold.
Damn!
I will drink you both. Dry.
I bet. Rita Rawlinson, how do you do? You look good for being undead.
Fool. Ha!
Hey, watch it! Steaks are out, garlic, forget it. Where is it? Aha! Back, undead creature.
A bruise of it. No!
That went well. Gordy, are you...
Down here, Carl. Is she...
She's gone. Here, let me help you out.
Thanks. Was that... was she really
Vampire. Yep, freshly turned.
I would have been...
Sucked dry, dead. And then you would have reawakened tomorrow night, just like her, and hungry for blood.
I owe you.
So now I have a clean tab?
No, I can't do that. Business is business, after all.
Business? But I just... Your...
Simmer down, Carl. I was thinking, maybe a nice fruitcake.
Fruitcakes! Fruitcakes! Figures. Well, Gordy, now that you're safe and as big a tightwad as ever, I'll see you later. I have an engagement to get to a certain Romanian prince's mansion. Oh, why didn't I join the circus instead of becoming a reporter? And next time, remind me not to be such a humanitarian on your behalf, Gordy! Fruitcake!
See ya, Carl. Payment's due on Tuesday.
Bah!
Upper West Side, Chicago, 1:45 a.m. A red Monte Carlo slowly pulls out and parks in front of a long, tree-covered drive leading to a Gothic mansion on a hill, the dark abode of Petri Ivan. After turning off the ignition, a certain intern of the INS News Service, better known as Monique Marmelstein, gets out of the driver's side door, followed by a certain advice columnist for the same INS News Service, one Emily Cowles, stepping out of the passenger door.
Think we should.
Oh, come on, Emily. I've got a hunch that Carl is onto something, and that Petri Ivan knows something about Rita's murder. I got an anonymous tip.
Okay, Monique.
But shouldn't we at least tell Mr. Vincenzo or Carl?
We don't need them. We can do this. Come on.
Oh.
Here we are. Now, act cool, Emily.
Cool? But I'm 60.
Oh, hush. Shh. If Carl Kolchak can do this, so can we. Okay. I grab the big gargoyle-shaped door knocker and...
No one's home, Monique. I think we should go. I have a hot game of Scrabble.
Oy, Emily. You know, maybe I should knock again.
You have come.
Who are you?
Master. Our last two guests have arrived.
Guests?
But how did you know that we...
Welcome. I am Petri Ivan. And you have come looking for...
Oh, answers. Now, who killed my friend, Rita Rollingstone?
She is not dead, my dear.
But... What? I don't... But...
She is reborn to the dark.
What? I don't,
Monique.
But
I think we should go.
Andrek, bring Mrs. Carls inside.
What?
We have a spot reserved at the Altar of Blood for her.
What?
Yes, master.
Oh, my arm. Monique, Emily,
let her go. Let her go, Monique.
Stay back.
Oh, what are you?
Master.
Ow, my arm.
Yana.
Monique!
Do not struggle!
Wait! Hey, you can't!
He can't!
My arm! My arm!
I have an acquaintance you might happen to know.
My arm!
Monique.
Rita! Rita, but you're dead, Rita!
She is undead.
How?
As am I.
What's going on? Vampires? Right.
Fool. Master, is this blood sack mine?
Rita?
After I have had her skin, I do have a ceremony to consecrate.
No! Rita!
Thank you for listening to Broken Sea Audio's Kolchak, the Night Stalker. Starring in Kolchak, the Night Stalker, Jeffrey Adams from the Icebox Radio as the man, the myth, the legend, Carl Kolchak, and W. Ralph Walters from the Zombie Astronauts Frequency of Fear as Tony Vincenzo, and starring as Monique Marmelstein, the amazing M. Sierra Garcia. Julie Hooverson of 19 Nocturne Boulevard starred as Emily. Gareth Preston of Westlake Film starred as Petri Ivan, the vampire. Stevie Farnaby, known for Escape from New York and Maudlin, starred as Petri Ivan's sidekick and Gollum, Andrak. Christy Plotkin starred as Lilith Cordescu. Paul Lavelle of Gaia fame starred as Police Captain Mad Dog Siska. Stevie Farnaby also starred as the cab driver. Elaine Barrett of Gaia's Voyages starred as Rita Rollingston. Gwendolyn Jensen Woodard of Gypsy Audio starred as Annette and Beb Lestrange. And Taylor Kent of the Snark Tank podcast starred as Gordy, the Ghoul Spangler, the Mortician. And Doug Manlin, the man, the myth, the slam dancer, starred as Officer O'Brien. I would also like to thank Brian of Seraph Panoply, composed the remixed version of the Kolchak theme, as well as some other bits and pieces. And Peter Wicks of Westlake Films for some incidental music. This is a fan tribute to Kolchak the Night Stalker, the original series from the 70s. Original story written by Bill Holwood, intro composed by Mark Kalita, based on characters created by the author Grant Rice. No copyright infringement is intended. All music, themes, and characters are the copyright of their respective owners. For more shows, check out www.brokensea.com.
Kolchak, the Night Stalker. One day, I shall come back. And return I did, several times, in several different bodies, though many would try to prevent it. Not allowed, me, but I'm allowed everywhere. However, I always manage to find my way. I just reversed the polarity of the neutron flow, and invited many lovely people along the way to come with me.
Would you like a jelly, baby?
It's gone on like that for a very long time, and although I say it myself, my adventures have become a stuff of legends. People have asked me, why do I keep doing it? It's quite simple, really. I'm the Doctor. It's what I do.
Broken Sea Audio presents Doctor Who, starring Mark Kalita as the Doctor and Adriana Melendez as Olivia Lethuel. This audio short is part of the Doctor Who podcast from Broken Sea Audio. For more information, go to www.brokensea.com/Doctor Who.
Listen. Can you hear them? Voices. A multitude of voices. Some whispering, some shouting, and some even screaming.
Listen to them.
They all have something to say. Don't listen too closely. You might not like what you hear.
Broken Sea Audio Productions presents the third annual Halloween audio season. Voices in the Dead of Night. October 2009. Concee.com.
Hi, I'm Big Anklevich.
And I'm Rish Outfield.
And that's R080T.
We're your hosts for the Doonstief audio fiction magazine.
On the Doonstief, we read science fiction, fantasy, and horror stories.
What did he say?
He says that you're a loser. If you've never listened to the Doonstief, you don't know what you're missing.
Stupid, worthless robot. Why don't we play them a sample?
Yeah, 080T, can you play that story sample? Javi slid the crystal into place. His accomplice fiddled with some knobs, and the spaceship came alive with a quiet whir. Outside, the guards were scrambling, confused at the ring of rolling blue fire that built under the machine. The wooden mounts vaporized and the ground blackened. The accomplice spoke.
Is it a go?
Yes,
Javi said. He turned on the space barrier and pulled the throttle. They shot upwards, crashing through the ceiling, leaving the guards on the ground pointing and shaking their heads. Thanks, 080T.
After the story, there's witty banter and discussion from the hosts. What did he say this time?
He says you're a loser. The best part about the discussion is that it's at the end, so it's easy just to skip it.
Right, so come check out the Doonstief audio fiction magazine.
Find us at www.doonstief.com.
That's DUNESTEEF. What did he say? That I'm a loser?
No, he said that if you check out the Doonstief, you'll be glad that you did. Huh. And he said that you're a loser.
Friggin' robot!
Upper West Side of Chicago, 10:01 p.m., a gothic mansion on a hill, a dark manse where evil now calls on an even greater evil.
Mm-hmm.
Andrek.
Master?
Please wake Miss Marmalstein.
As you will, Master.
Oh, my. Vey, what a... Where am I? Oh, my head. Where the hell am I? I don't feel so good. What's with the chains? I'm chained? What the hell?
Hell beckons.
What? I don't...
Miss Marmalstein.
What? Where is Emily?
She will be the fount of the Crimson Purge to come. While you, Monique, will sound the clarion call with your scream.
What?
It nears midnight. The time to call the King of Ghouls. Andrek.
Master.
As soon as the rest of our vampiric circle arrives at Wrigley Field.
Wrigley Field.
We begin.
Wrigley Field. Wrigley Field? Wrigley Field. What with... What does a supposed vampire want with the Chicago Cubs baseball stadium? Are you kidding me?
Why, Miss Marmalstein, do you find this amusing?
Wrigley Field? Right. Are you kidding? The next thing you know, you'll be telling me Shoeless Joe and the Black Sox are all back from the grave to play a few innings.
No. Shoeless Joe and his fellow players will not be here this night. Monique, you do not believe in the vampire?
Oh, come on! This is 1973! What I do believe is that you are a deranged, murdering lunatic!
How quaint, even with the truth standing before you, America is but a lamb simply waiting to be led to my slaughter. Rita Rollingston was so easy to slay.
You
and give the dark kiss
what?
To.
Just let me go.
Andrek.
Yes, Master.
Ensure that the cutlery is sharpened and blessed in the unholy waters of Droga. Until then, do siphon me off, eh? Snifter of Miss Marmalstein's blood.
Yes, Master.
No, you stay back. Don't you touch me.
You start to believe. Good.
Oh, it can't be. Oh, my God.
I seem to have worked up a bit of an appetite.
No, get away from me. No!
Scream to your heart's desire, mortal.
No, you can't.
No one will ever
find. Get away from me.
Other than the Lord of Ghouls. Andrek, get the limousine ready for the commute to this Wrigley Field. Isn't it ever
no,
so
stay
lovely
back.
When
no,
they
no.
scream?
My name is Carl Kolchak, former reporter for INS, Chicago's very own independent news service. In all my years of investigative journalism, I've seen some pretty strange things. Today, you'd simply look at them as amusing fodder for the national tabloids. But hear me out when I tell you that they're real. The vampires, androids, ghosts, swamp creatures, monkey men, and even Jack the Ripper. Yes, every last one. Rather than jeopardize my former editor's sanity with such sensational tales, I simply left out the details for public consumption. Oh, I kept the real transcripts, conveniently tucked away from the curious eye, in a file under the innocuous name All Saints Archive. But now, happily retired, I believe I can finally release the full accounts, as I actually experienced them. Prepare yourself now for one of many cases from the All Saints Archive, or as I call them, the Night Stalker Incidents. This night's tale, Playground for Evil. Episode 4. Having left Gordy's morgue and saving him from the undead clutches of one Rita Rawlinson, I went home and fell asleep mulling over all the events of the day. The next morning I went to the dark manse of one Petri Ivan, but the gates were locked and the guard dogs huge, so after driving around Chicago, avoiding my editor Tony like the plague, I came up with zilch. Tempted to contact Lilith Cordescu, and she had already disappeared. So with no new leads, I continued driving around Chicago, something nagging at me. And finally, well after sunset, hungry and no closer to solving much of anything, I headed for the one place I knew I could get some straight answers and information. Murray Salami's Antique Bookstore and Barbecue Spit. Okay, there have been better nom de plumes for businesses since the dawn of time, and this was not one of them, but they do have a great rack of ribs, and it's cheap, and I was hungry. Hunting vampires is hungry business, let me tell you. Anyway, I need to find out more about ghouls, undead, Romanian princes, and Murray knew everything or had a book on everything that was anything about the occult, if you were a paying customer. Wonder if he accepts IOUs. Anyway, did I mention I was hungry?
Check, I'm friggin' closed! It's 10:15 at night for crying out loud! Thought journalists could friggin' read! Oh, forgot! It's you!
Bonnie Murray, everyone's a comedian. Just open the door!
Hey, what do you want, Kolchak?
I need a favor.
Carl, let me explain something to you so even you can understand. I am closed.
Vampires, ghoul lords, doom, destruction.
What?
Murray, it's a big paranormal shindig. Transylvanian soiree to end all soirees. Hell's throwing a party right here in Chicago, and the city's on the menu.
Kolchak, I got in my shop at 4 friggin' a.m. and have to put up with some damn picky customers all friggin' day. And I was just locking up and getting ready to head home and feed my cat. And
you have a cat?
Why are you the... No, 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 no. I promised my friggin' padre to turn over a new leaf. Stop beating the annoying customer senses. Kolchak, Get out of my shop and go home!
Murray, the undead! You can't just let the city go to...
Mr. Salami, you'd remember me, do you not?
Yes, ma'am,
Lilith.
Yes, Mr. Gal. Me. Invite me in, Mr. Salami.
Now!
Yes, ma'am. And freely of your own freaking will.
Thank you. Come along, Mr. Gal.
Yeah. They're coming.
You're with her?
Yep. Oh, can I get a rack of ribs while we browse your occult library?
Oh!
Mr.
Han,
hurry! We do not have much time.
Better make that to go.
Check.
Oh, Emmy. Me too. We're in Wrigley Field, Han. We're chained up in the middle of the center field cheap seats for some reason or another.
Silence! The Master begins the summoning.
My gathered vampiri outcasts. As the full cycle of the moon rises, the ritual must commence in this, the midnight hour. I have called you all here to this mortal stadium of the cub to join me, my Nosferatu brothers and sisters. The Elder of the Nightbreed has disowned us. They have banished us. The fools have spit on our accomplishments. But no more. On this mound before you, in the center of this edifice to mortal sport, sets a cauldron of mystic opportunity. By the dark gods, and with your undead assistance, I will call on the Lord of Ghouls this Hallows Eve night. He will grant us divine power, and retribution shall be ours. Look, my Nightbreed brothers and sisters, look to the center field of seats, and check. Light the torches! The mortal sacrifices await, chained before you on high in those seats, their warm blood awaiting to be spilt. My gathered vampiri, I now begin the invocation. Abra, Dakra. Ula, Ralok,
Aura, Dakra, Ula, Ralok,
Dakra,
Dakra,
Ula, Ralok,
Aura, Dakra, Ula, Ralok,
Ara, Dakra, Ula, Ralok,
Ara, Dakra,
Ula, Ralok,
Ara, Dakra,
Ula, Ralok.
Lilith, what are you doing here at Murray's, and why are you helping me?
Oh, Mr. Carl, it amuses me, as do you. So I thought I might assist your endeavor to undo this, Petri Ivan. Why do you whisper?
Because I don't want Murray to understand.
Mr. Salami knows fully who and what I am. But the book we seek must be found soon. I can feel the necromantic energy is building up. Up there under the cobwebs and dust on top of the bookcase.
This one up? Oh, here, move this box. Jeez, could the bookcase be any taller and dustier? There, now, here, this...
This one?
Here, Colchak.
Got it.
Your ring.
Wow. Whoa!
Well, Colchak, there's your ribs all over the floor.
Oh, and barbecue sauce all over my Sears sucker. My back.
Mr. Carl, you are not the most graceful of mortals.
Thanks. Hey, a rib landed in my pocket. Maybe the day isn't so bad after all. It hurts when I laugh. My back. Is this the book?
Colchak, you're getting stains all over my book.
How can you tell with all the dust?
Colchak!
Oh, mortals. Do stop your bickering. You both sound like hyenas in here.
Hyenas?
Mark Anthony had a pair. He was so fond of them, you know?
You knew Mark Anthony?
Yes, but that was a long time ago.
How old are you?
Carl, one never asks the lady's age, mortal or vampire.
Freaking idiot. I could have told you that, Colchak.
Oh, shut up, Murray. You're not the one covered in barbecue sauce.
This is the book, The Elzareth Canticle. I do not know if this will work.
I've solved this and now it's not going to work. Why?
Murray, do you know of the nails of Narad used in Romania?
Nails of Narad. Narad. Yeah. They were friggin'. They were supposed to be cursed. A large amount were imported back here when Wrigley. They were used in a building on the bleachers in the center field at Wrigley Stadium. People here have been blaming them for all the friggin' Cubs' bad luck.
You gotta be kidding.
No, Mr. Carl. They are the same nails used to pin that note threatening you to the head of the transient.
Great. Okay, but beyond the grisly use of carpentry condiments, what does it mean?
It makes the Wrigley Field the perfect slaughtering ground to summon the Lord of Ghouls.
Okay, strange as all this sounds, been down this road before, so I'll buy
you. Interesting choice of words, Mr. Carl.
Now you did it.
There is one other problem.
And that is?
Yak droppings. I will explain later, but we are in need of...
Well, Mistress Lilith, you see, I can help. Or, more precisely, my brother Hammy Salami can. He runs a livestock trucking service, you know. And for some reason, he just so happens to be transporting...
For Pete's sake.
So I found out that Murray Salami's brother, Hammy Salami, don't ask, had a trailer full of yak poop. Again, don't ask. Moving along, Lilith bade Murray and I, yes, that's the word she used, bade, vampires do all talk like that. Anyway, we were to bring said poop to Wrigley Field, home of the Chicago Cubs baseball franchise, possibly cursed by one Pietri Ivan, vampire, with delusions of grandeur. Jeez, they haven't won a pennant since the turn of the century. There may be something to this Romanian nail curse. Back to Murray. Me and Tibet's proudest export, the yak. How can I or Murray refuse Lilith? She was a vampire, after all, and trust me, if you saw the slinky thing she was wearing... Well, she didn't need to hypnotize either of us, let's put it that way. But where was I? Right. We got into the semi-truck with said open trailer of yak poop and drove to Wrigley Field, parking under the center field bleachers. Murray had a key. How, do you ask? You see, his other brother, Brought W. Salami, worked security at Wrigley Field and acquired said key for Murray. The Salami family was nothing if not diligent and employed in the most bizarre of occupations. Again, don't ask me about the Salami family genealogy or the nom de plume of the Salami brood. In any event, Murray and I were parked on the street behind the center field bleachers in a loading zone with one trailer filled to odoriferous proportions with yak refuse. And I was covering myself in said poop. Wait, listen, I said I had a good reason. The reason, you ask? You have to understand, Lilith's dress was very... becoming. Hell, she made most supermodels look like ugly bat victims from birth, if you know what I mean. Because of certain mystic qualities in yaks from Tibet, including their excrement, Lilith assured Murray and I that said yak droppings would protect us both from the coming of the aforementioned Ghoul Lord and his diabolical powers of darkness. Murray was more than dubious, but he was under Lilith's dress, spell, as well. Though all the while weaving a string of curses that would have made a sailor blush with every handful of yak excrement smeared on his person. While all this was going down on the street, we were told to wait while Lilith went to the stadium to confront one Pietri Ivan, vampire a vampire. Sans being covered in said yak poop, I might add Lilith was still the owner of one slinky dress that fit her every curve to perfection as she headed off into Wrigley Field. Wrigley Field has no lights for night games, so it was dark and cold and eerie as she disappeared around the corner. Just then I heard the chirping of a bat. Sometimes, being a journalist gets downright weird.
Gathering of the night breed with your holy utterances.
Petrie? But why? What are you gonna do to—
Why, Miss Marmalstein, a very dark and cosmic alignment which happens only once in a millennia now beckons. One I have not seen since the time of the Pharaoh, when I was known by another name. Mark Antony. What do I plan to do, you ask? Why, sacrifice you both to the Lord of Doom.
You cad! You stay away from her, you brute!
Miss Cowards, aren't we all worked up? But it will avail you not, for shortly you are to be flayed alive.
I can
and will. The cutlery and the first skin. Annette's will do. And Drek.
Yes, master.
Dark One, I call to thee. Absor, Dracon, Vool, open the portal.
Yes.
Thank you, my outcast vampiri brothers and sisters. The time has come. Vorkas, Dark Lord of Ghouls, I call upon thee. Take this flayed skin of immortals as a tribute and guarantee of offerings to come, and use it to guide me here from thy nether realm.
What does a mere vampire need with Lorcas? Lord of Ghouls!
Power over vampire fools who would oppose me.
There is a price, vampire.
The price is chained here before you in this mortal sporting stadium. The very nails of this stadium's construction, cursed in your dark name. Long I have awaited this cosmic alignment. I might call upon thee, Valorcas. I bid you now enter freely into this mortal realm and feast.
Yes! I can taste the fear from a cross the Asperger's. The Lord of Ghouls! Accept!
Survive tonight, I'm gonna kill you for this!
Look, Murray, think of it as the ending of the Curse of the Cubbies.
Kolchak, you're both covered in freaking yak patties.
Consider taking one for the team.
I got you taking it for the team right here.
Ernie Banks would be ashamed.
Ernie Banks ain't covered in yak.
Shit. That's Monique.
Who?
Monique Marmelstein. She works with me at INS. Petri Ivan has her here. Stay here, Murray. I gotta save her.
Just great.
Look, you watch the truck and be ready with the sharpened pool cue like Lilith told you.
What are you gonna do?
Take my canteen of holy water and my sharpened rake and stop a vampire.
Paul!
What?
Here. You might need him to get inside a friggin' stadium.
Thanks. You're okay.
Don't spread it around, Carl. Hey, Kolchak.
What now?
Good luck.
Thanks.
You'll need it.
Monique? Is that chanting I hear?
But I hope we're not too messianic or a trifle too satanic. We are a bit of blue. Well, I am just a monk of man. I'm glad you are a monk.
Disincantation now!
Who dares?
I do it! Lilith! The rest of you vampiric outcasts, be gone! Before I impale every last one of you like I did to that fool! I am your elder! I am Lilith Cordescu! Obey me now!
What? My vampire brood runs? Who? You.
Yes, this is I, Lilith, your former love, Petri. Or should I say Mark Antony? This blasphemy of yours is true.
Never! The Lord of Ghouls enters this realm even now. I need those fools not. Bow before me, Lilith. And together, we can recapture the glory of Egypt.
I don't think so, vampire.
Who dares?
Stay back, vampire. I have holy water.
Mortal fool. The Lord of Ghouls even now enters this hell. Your holy water now stains the seats, fool.
How did you do that?
I have no time for this. It is that smell. Breed of yak.
Monique, Emily, chase! Oh my
God!
Green orange beast with glowing red eyes. Now what do I do?
No! Grab Kolchak.
He is protected.
My time. Monsieur.
Get away from him, Mortal! You are killing the Lord Fool!
My car! Get away from the edge of the stadium! Stay back from Kolchak, Petri! By my dark right, I call upon the lightning to stop you now!
No!
America's best-selling, best-tasting filter cigarette.
Winston tastes good like a cigarette.
this car friggin' doing up there?
Pool cue!
Carl, what are you doing in a trailer full of yak shit?
Murray, get the steak!
Steak? Steak? Oh, the friggin' pool cue right here! Let me help you out. Jesus, what the hell? Green Fang Bozo call? He's friggin' melted.
Don't worry about him, it's the other one! Murray! Murray, the steak!
Not this time, Fang.
What?
So, we survived. It's been a few months since that dreadful October night. Baseball season has just started again, and things are in bloom all around the city of Chicago. And as for what happened that fateful night? Well, after falling over 100 feet into yak excrement. Don't try that one at home, kiddies. Anyway, Murray Salami impaled one Patry Ivan with a sharpened pool cue, ending a vampire reign of terror that from all accounts stretched back to and possibly before the rise of the pyramids in ancient Egypt. The Ghoul Lord was undone by the same fall into the sacred excrement of livestock hailing from Tibet, namely the aforementioned yak. All's well that smells well, or unwell. And what of Lilith? How did she know to have Murray park the trailer full of yak poop specifically on the street below the centerfield bleachers, and, in the process, saving me from the previously mentioned fall after being struck by a flagpole that had also been struck by a seemingly random lightning bolt? Did Lilith control said bolt of electricity, or was it in the dog and lock of one car bolt shaft? I will never know. And she will not say.
Some things a girl will never tell.
Lilith?
Oh, do go on, Mr. Cal.
Anyway, after many days of showers, buying a new suit, yak droppings just won't come out of white seersucker, trust me, I tried, and lots of inoculations for the splash into said yak refuge, I was okay. Oh, I almost forgot. Tony and Mad Dog Siska showed up right after the Ghoul King had disintegrated and Patry Ivan, vampire overlord wannabe, had turned to ash. Tony had a coronary, as is his modus operandi, and proceeded to overdose on Rolaids, and then forbade me to write about any of this, and wouldn't listen to me anyway. Go figure. Mad Dog, on the other hand, was his usual incensed self, though his therapist had dulled an edge or two here or there. Mad Dog wrote both me and Murray Salami a traffic ticket for illegal parking of livestock refuge, and ordered us to get out of Chicago before he buried us under police HQ. Murray still won't talk to me. Monique and Emily are fine now, though neither will eat anything without a generous helping of garlic, and both refuse to go to any sporting events. On a side note, apparently the cursed nails of one Patry Ivan did not in fact curse his vampire brothers, who turned their talent back on him. Carpentry and the Carpathians do not mix. The Chicago Cubs, on the other hand, are just as bad this year, curse or no. And Patry Ivan's golem familiar? With Patry's death, he turned back into a stone statue from whence he had formed. He is now a fixture in the cheap seats at Wrigley. Did I mention that the Cubs are still losing? As for Lilith, that gorgeous creature of the night, she promised to swear off drinking blood from the living, except for the criminals of the most dire kind. And you know something? I believe her. And what of Rita Rawlingston? Lilith got to her soon enough before she turned into a mindless killing machine, and she has taken her under her wing. They're starting an avenging vampire corporation. Or so I'm told.
Mr. Cal. I would like to see this lookout point.
Lookout point?
I would like to explore this motor custom of, how you say? Necking.
Necking? Okay, true believers, I have a date. And, with Miss Cordescu, I... Yeah, some things are better left...
Mr. Cal! How do you like my dress?
Unset. Dress? Oh, my. Jeez, yes. She always gets me with that dress. Good night, folks. Until next time, this is Carl Kolchak, the Night Stalker, saying...
Ciao, my pretties.
I said to him, you can't always get what you want. No. You can't always get what you want. It just might find you get what you need. Oh yeah.
Woo! Thank you for listening to Broken Sea Audio's Kolchak, the Night Stalker, Part 4. Starring in Kolchak, the Night Stalker, Jeffrey Adams from the Icebox Radio as the man, the myth, the legend, Carl Kolchak. And W. Ralph Walters from the Zombie Astronauts Frequency of Fear as Tony Vincenzo. And starring as Monique Marmelstein, the amazing M. Sierra Garcia. Julie Hooverson of 19 Nocturne Boulevard starred as Emily. Gareth Preston of Westlake Film starred as Petri Ivan, the vampire. Stevie Farnaby, known for a skit from New York and Maudlin, starred as Petri Ivan's sidekick and Gollum on track. Christy Plotkin starred as Lilith Cordescu. Paul Lavelle of Gaia fame starred as police captain Mad Dog Siska. Stevie Farnaby also starred as the cab driver. Elaine Barrett of Gaia's Voyages starred as Rita Rollingston. Gwendolyn Jensen Woodard of Gypsy Audio starred as Annette and Beb Lestrange. And Taylor Kent of the Snark Tank Podcast starred as Gordy, the Ghoul Spangler, the Mortician. And Doug Manlin, the man, the myth, the slam dancer, starred as Officer O'Brien. And Stephen J. Cohen as Murray Salami. And Stevie Farnaby as Florgas, the Ghoul Lord. Starring as the Chanting Vampires, Alexa Chipman, Brian of Seraphic Panoply, Tanya Milojevic, Gary Cobham, Paul Lavelle, Taylor Kent, Stevie Farnaby, and Bill Holwig. This cast has been brilliant, and I hope you enjoy Kolchak, the Night Stalker. I would also like to thank Brian of Seraphic Panoply, composed the remixed version of the Kolchak theme, as well as some other bits and pieces, and Peter Wicks of Westlake Films for some incidental music. This is a fan tribute to Kolchak, the Night Stalker, the original series from the 70s. Original story written by Bill Holwood, intro composed by Mark Kalita, based on characters created by the author Grant Rice. No copyright infringement is intended. All music, themes, and characters are the copyright of their respective owners. Coming in 2010, more Kolchak, written by Mike Murphy. For more shows, check out www.brokensea.com.
Broken Sea Audio presents Kolchak, the Night Stalker.
Journey to a faraway land where swords and sorcery decide the fate of kingdoms. Travel the paths of warriors and wizards as they fulfill a forgotten prophecy, culminating in a furious battle between the forces of darkness and light. The adventures begin in a humble tavern filled with tall tales and dark secrets. Sit thee down and hearken to the saga of the Grog and Griffin. only at Westlake Films, in conjunction with Broken Sea Audio, where fantasy audio is forged.
In the year 1988, the crime rate in the United States rises 400%. The once great city of New York becomes the one maximum security prison for the entire country. This is the Broken Sea Audio production of Escape from New York.
Coming 2009, the mayhem begins.
You go in, find the president, and bring him out in 24 hours, and you're a free man.
I'll think about it.
No time. Give me an answer.
So get a new president. Trade Center dead ahead. Should be there now. Said, hold on.
Where'd you learn to drive?
Come, Snake.
Without warning, they came from the sky. Creatures, similar in origin, yet so very different from us.
Commander Taylor, the ship is now entering the Barbarian Quadrant.
Wonderful.
The time has come for...
I'm getting there. Space. So ends my last signal until we reach our destination.
We called them ignorant. Savages. Until one day, one of the beasts spoke.
Taylor! Why'd you run away?
Security police, Dr. Zira.
I'm in charge of this man.
No longer, Dr. Zira. He is now in my custody. General Ursus.
Get your stinking paws off me, you damn dirty ape.
Taylor!
And the teachings of our great lawgiver were called into question.
Beware the beast man, for he is the devil's paw. Let him not breed in great numbers, or he will make a desert of his home and yours. Shun him, for he is the harbinger of death.
Indeed, we learn the truth, and we exposed what had for many generations been forbidden. The man-beast also possessed an intellect, one that made him all the more dangerous.
Praise the Alpha.
Bless the Omega.
Praise the wisdom of the bomb.
Join us once again as Broken Sea Audio Productions takes you beyond the imagination into the land beneath the Planet of the Apes. Adapted and expanded from the original script by Paul Denn and Mort Abrams, based on the world created by Pierre Boulle. Only at BrokenSea.com.
Thank you.
And that's this week's show. We'll all catch you next week as we continue our look back at the genius of Bill Hallwick. Thanks so much again, Jeff and Lothar, for the ride.
Welcome, Jack. I'll see you next week.
Absolutely. Looking forward to Battlestar Galactica coming up.
Yeah.
From West Texas.
How have you been doing? What you been up to? Tell us, Mr. Buccaneer. How's it been for you? Have you kissed the mermaids under the sky so blue? Listen to the siren song. What to do. If you'd like to tell us, we would love to hear. Share some of your rum with us, and we will be all ears.
Because on the way back, I took the long way home by Mullins Crossing. Damn, it rocks!
Have you been splashing with the dolphins? Swimming with the whales? A calm and quiet ocean? Up comes a feisty gale, ringing around the masthead. Lightning, rain, and wind. Did you ever wonder? When will your journey end? We would really love to hear what you've been up to. Tell us, Mr. Buccaneer, how's it been for you? How's it been for you?
Those who believe that life here began out there, far across the universe. Some believe that there may yet be brothers of man who even now fight to survive far, far away amongst the stars.
What is it now, Centurion?
Squadron Phalanx formed. We await your command to commence the assault on Galactica.
Do it!
By your command.
And I will dance on all your graves. Lucifer, begin!
By your command, Voltar.
This is Apollo, launching now.
Copy, Apollo.
Let's bag some chrome domes. Welcome to Starbuck Land, where the qubits fly and Cylons die.
Hold the chatter. Here they come.
Boomer, roll right. You got one on your tail.
Frack!
Fire!
Got another! Apollo! This is two... What the frack are they doing?
What do you mean, Starbuck?
What are they doing? They're heading towards the Jupiter?
That's what's worrying me. Starbuck, follow me.
Sheba, this is Galactica. Break off your patrol and intercept two incoming Cylon Raiders. Copy?
Incoming Colonial Viper. We'll move to intercept.
Galactica!
there! The other Raider's on a collision course with the Jupiter. Far off from my blaster. Galactica, do you copy?
Coming to Broken Sea Audio Productions, 2008. BrokenSea.com.